Buonasera, benvenuti a New York University, Casa Italiana Zerilli-Marimò. My name is Stefano Albertini, I'm the director, and it's with particular pleasure that I introduce this evening dedicated to futurism as part of our city poetry and the city. As you know, we inaugurated a couple of weeks ago our series with Corrado Calabro, who is a contemporary and very much alive poet, and we are stepping back in time on some level to futurism, that is arguably the most important literary event that came out of Italy in the 20th century. We're not strictly speaking talking about poetry tonight, but definitely about literature and the relationship of literature with the city. And we are presenting two books. One is Venezianella and Studentaccio, that is a 1944 novel by Filippo Tommaso Marinetti that has just been published a few months ago for the first time, thanks to the editorial work of Paolo, Valesio and Patrizio Ceccagnoli. And then we are presenting another book that is ModernItalia, Jeffrey Schnapp, and it's my particular pleasure not to give you a formal presentation of Professor Schnapp, but just to welcome him back to the Casa. I think the last time you were here, you talked about rayon as the fiber of the fascist revolution. It was a particularly brilliant talk. And to me, is a real pleasure to welcome back Professor Schnapp, because he was my mentor and professor at Stanford University, where I got my PhD, and I remember very fondly the course I took with him on anni 30, where he would make us read these unheard of fascist novels, but the discussions and the lectures of Professor Schnapp remain in my mind and in my heart as particularly inspiring and thought-provoking. So I'm delighted that you have a chance to experience for a short period of time what I had the fortune and the luxury to experience for the time of my studying at Stanford. So welcome back to the free. And of course, it's a pleasure to welcome Jennifer Scappettone back to Casa Italiana. We hosted a presentation of her book of the translations of the poetry of Amelia Rosselli here just a few months ago, and it's a great pleasure to welcome her back, no longer as a translator, but as a poetry critic. And of course, welcome back to Paolo Valesio. I just want to remind you that the next event in the series Poetry in the City will feature Professor Valesio, not as a literary scholar, as you will hear him tonight, but as a poet himself. So we'll present his last book of poems with the participation of another Italian poet, Davide Rondoni, and we're very excited about that as well. And instead, I would like to hand the floor to Patrizio Ceccagnoli, providing invaluable help in coordinating and conceiving these Poetry in the City series. Thank you all very much, and welcome to everybody.
La laguna, tutta contenta di pesare e ripesare sulle sue bilance di cristallo, glicine e rose straripate dai giardini, ne butta il soprappiù per la finestra dentro alla cameretta di Studentaccio, ma svegliato scende dal letto e giù per la scaletta fin sui gradini erbosi che, liquidandosi, sognano di diventare prato. Which is more or less this, and which is the beginning of a book we are presenting tonight, one of the two books we are presenting tonight, a posthumous lyrical novel written by the father of futurism, Filippo Tommaso Marinetti, in the last year of his life, in 1944. From the man who once wanted to destroy Venice, is a new book on Venice, in which the protagonist aims to create a new Venice. It's a pleasure for me to speak about this book as a result of long years of studying with my former advisor, Professor Paolo Valesio, who edited with me this novel, and it was perfect to have the luck of having Professor Schnapp, who is also an editor of Marinetti, since he published the famous series, the Oscar Mondadori, the collection of theatrical works of Marinetti few years ago, and Professor Jennifer Scappettone, who is a poet and translator, but also an excellent scholar, whose new book is about Venice modernism, and therefore she is a perfect interlocutor for this conversation about this book and Venetian modernism and Italian modernism. And I thank, of course, Stefano.
I proceed then,
the book, as Dr. Bertini mentioned, just came out, has been released by Mondadori at the end of January, but after 60 years of oblivion. Scholars knew about its existence in the form of typescript at the Beinecke Library at Yale University, but when Professor Bresser and I started to establish the test, we discover the existence of a manuscript which is preserved in a Milanese archive, and therefore we have to start again all the work we have been doing, we have done on the book, to establish a definitive text that you find in this new edition, which features this beautiful cover. And I say beautiful because we didn't choose it, the editor did, with one of the first masterpieces of Marinetti's wife, Benedetta Cappa, entitled Velocità di Motoscafo from the 20s and preserved in Rome, and which of course features this, the theme of speed and with a motorboat fading away, and the wave that provides this idea of dynamicity and speed, which is so typical of the aesthetics and poetics of futurism in the arts and literature as well, as theorized by Marinetti. Obviously, I assume you understand that the ghost of Marinetti didn't appear to us, and neither he provided us with a digital file of the manuscript of the text. On the contrary, we had to work on a very troubled manuscript written by three different persons. This is the beginning of the book with a title, and which is not written by Marinetti, and it's not even written by Benedetta Cappa. It was a tradition in the family that Benedetta, according to which Benedetta used to write at the beginning of Marinetti's works, but it didn't happen for this lyrical novel. And maybe Professor Bresser is going to say something about the genre and its pertinence in this series. But the book, this first page, in which you can read more or less what I've been reading at the beginning of this talk, has been written by a futurist painter and theorician, Giovanni Acquaviva, and was born in 1900, and was a very close collaborator of Marinetti in his last years, also in Venice, where of course he wrote this page when Marinetti was recovering, actually was in bad shape after his participation at the Second World War in the Russian front. And Marinetti spent his last winter in Venice, where he escaped with his family from Rome, and in which he in Venice he had a very prolific phase of his career, in which he wrote many works, many books that have been published posthumously, and some of which are still unpublished. This is the handwriting of Marinetti, the manuscript page, and you can tell that there are many corrections, and so it was not easy at all to establish some criterion for the establishing the text, which, as you can tell from this page, feature some of the typical characteristics of futurist poetics. More importantly, the abolition of punctuation, and also the demolition of syntax rules, syntactical rules of syntax, and therefore this was one of the issues we have to face when we put on the page the manuscript. And I'm just going to give you a brief overview about this book. And this book, as I said, is written in Venice, speaks about Venice, and features on the title the name of the two protagonists, Venezianella and Studentaccio, two talking names which are very difficult to translate. We were discussing on the train with Professor Valesio, how can we translate that? And ending with the conclusion that probably we cannot translate that. Of course, we can say little Venice and the bad student, but this wouldn't probably fully translate the implication and the connotation of the name of these two protagonists. I will just briefly mention the main plot. Venezianella is a Red Cross nurse who is arriving in an ambulance at the beginning of the first chapter in Venice, where Studentaccio, who is a futurist, is the leader on the yard and the construction site for the construction of a new Venice. Studentaccio is responsible, is in charge for this ambitious project, and he has to face the hostility of some glass workers within the same group of futurists and a platoon of rats guided by a talking rat who's fighting against the futurists and providing an obstacle for the construction of this new Venice. In the meantime, there is a romantic plot which seems to go against the scornful woman and proclaimed by Marinetti in the founding manifesto of futurism in 1909. And because Venezianella is a muse for Studentaccio, but Studentaccio is in love with her. But in the best tradition of Italian literature, Venezianella is quite enigmatic and always in a fight, flight from Studentaccio, and so we witness a series of chasing scenes in which Studentaccio, while he's concerned with the problem related to the construction of this new Venice, is also looking for Venezianella in the lagoon. Eventually, we'll build this new Venice with the help of the other futurist workers, and this new Venice is built within Venice in the river di Schiavoni, and the city itself is not destroyed though. You might recall, of course, one of the early manifestos written by Marinetti in collaboration with the painter Carrà Balla and the musicologist Ruffolo, painter himself, in which he was claiming for the destruction of Venice in order to create a new commercial harbor. The manifesto was entitled Contro Venezia Passatista, against traditionalist Venice or against passatist Venice, which was written in 1910. Well, in this lyrical novel written in 1944, Venezianella e Studentaccio, the city is rebuilt in the shape of a gigantic statue. And so in my afterword, I emphasize on this idea of a fetish, because this new Venice is a gigantic statue in the shape of a woman resembling Venezianella, but at the same time this statue is consists of the superimposition of pre-existing monuments of from the architecture of the city. So the gigantic curve is made by seven basilicas of San Marco. The upper body is made by the Ducal Palace in Venice, and all overwhelmed by the Cadoro. And so it's a complete nonsense image in, that Marinetti conceived to represent this new image of a city. And as you, I'm showing you some quotes from the book, and in which you can appreciate the polemical and typical verve of Marinetti, but also, for instance, in the third quote, the use of that of Venetian dialect that is employed in the novel. So, cosa c'è lo futuristic, the gente che vede il mondo all'incontrario, which is a fun, indulgent definition of the movement given by this, by Marinetti himself. When we have to choose, though, a quotation for the end, for the back cover of the book, the editor was particularly fond of this one, which is not very representative of the spirit of the novel, but is probably more effective than others. So Venezia è una rotta brocca d'acqua caduta nella cacca, with this assonanza of the repetition of the vowel A, which expressed the first polemical spirit and attitude of Marinetti with regard of Venice as a symbol of the past of a romantic city. I'm gonna skip some passages, but this I'm sorry, this eschatological theme was present already in the early manifesto when Marinetti speaks about the sterco che I mammut lasciarono cadere qua là nell'attraversare a guado le vostre preistoriche lagune, and therefore there are many intertextual passage connections between the different works of Marinetti devoted to Venice, because if we all know probably about the manifesto, which is the most famous one among the work that Marinetti devoted to Venice, if we now discover this new novel, we must also recall that Marinetti wrote a play called Ricostruire l'Italia Architettura Futurista Fantelia, which is part of the anthology edited by Professor Schnapp. But he also published, wrote an early drama, an historical drama set in Venice at the beginning of his career, which remained without a title, which is always often referred to with the name of a protagonist, Paolo Baglione. So there's a long, the long familiarity, a long acquaintance, a long, I don't know, relationship through all the along the whole career of Marinetti. I'm not going to show you this video because I want to maybe later if we have time. But we can find online a beautiful interpretation of this manifesto by the famous actor and dramatist Carmelo Bene.
Give us 2 minutes.
Yes, you like it? Yeah. Me too. Okay.
Aprile 1910 contro Venezia fatta vista. Noi ripudiamo l'antica Venezia estenuata e spassa, la volontà scolare come pure amammo e soffedemmo in un gran sogno nostalgico. Ripudiamo la Venezia dei forestieri, mercato di antiquari, falsificatori, calamita dell'ottomismo, dell'imbecillità universale, letto sfondato da carovane, chiamanti, semicupio ingermato per cortigiane cosmopolite, cloaca, massima del passatismo. Noi vogliamo guarire e cicatrizzare questa città putrefatta, piaga magnifica del passato. Noi vogliamo rianimare e nobilitare il popolo veneziano decaduto dalla sua antica grandezza, morfinizzato da una vigliaccheria stomachevole e avvilito nell'abitudine dei suoi commerci loschi. Noi vogliamo preparare la nascita di una Venezia industriale e militare che possa dominare il mare Adriatico, gran lago italiano. Affrettiamoci a colmare i piccoli canali puzzolenti con le macerie dei vecchi palazzi collanti e nebrosi. Bruciamo le gondole, poltrone a dondolo per cretini. E innalziamo fino al cielo l'imponente geometria dei punti metallici e degli opifici chiomati di fumo per abolire le curve cascanti delle vecchie architetture. Venga finalmente il regno della divina luce elettrica a liberare Venezia dal suo venale chiaro di luna da camera ammobiliata.
Wonderful reading, public reading. Yes, there are more seats here if available if you need one.
Okay.
And it was worth listening to it. But I skip some of the quotation. I also skip the reference to the fall of the Tower Bell of San Marco, because I noticed that also Jennifer is going to speak about that. I just want to point it out that when we speak about Marinetti and his attitude toward Venice and his idea of destroying the canals to create an harbor, we have to historicize this statement and think that when he wrote his manifesto in 1910, and just in that year, the first Italian translation of Ruskin's Stone of Venice was just released, and at the same time in Venice they were rebuilding the campanile, which fell down in 1902, causing an immediate reaction from the municipality, which was accused for some negligence by the population, but also causing a public debate about the technique and the style for the reconstruction of the same historical monument. And so there were architects who proposed to build the campanile in a completely different style, but a more traditional solution prevailed, and the campanile was rebuilt as it was, where it was, just in 10 years. And so here we have some pictures about it. And I just want to conclude about with these quotations in which you can tell how the new Venice is built and is conceived in the novel. So the protagonist, Studentaccio, speaks in a kind of press release and address the journalist present in the audience. And I read: cari giornalisti, vi accontento con poche parole importantissime. La nuova Venezia è un ingrandimento dei più tipici palazzi, delle più tipiche chiese, combinati e sovrapposti, ma con una varietà di materiali che li metamorfosa. So we speak about transformation, metamorphosis, but also a reuse of a typical palace and buildings of pre-existing architecture. La riva degli scavoni da tempo trasformata nel tumultuoso cantiere che circonda e nutre di nuove forme e colori la già alta Nuova Venezia, con la sua chilometrica ondulata gonna di pompose basiliche San Marco, e al di sopra si innalza il nuovo ingigantito palazzo ducale, schiena e petto architettonico con diametro 500 metri. So here we have a description of this surrealistic image with the kilometrica gonna, with this gigantic skirt, and the basilicas of San Marco, which cost of which this statue, this new Venice, consists. And therefore we have the final quote in which Studentaccio speaks with Venezianella about her possible objections to his technique. Venezianella, intuisco la tua critica all'architettura di ciò che sarà il nostro capolavoro e che certamente tu sognavi sgomba di qualsiasi ricordo del passato, ma voglio sia la tua scultura smisuratamente ingigantita, cioè la bellissima veneziana ideale alla moda veneziana, e che ti rassomigli veramente come tu rassomigli a San Marco, al Palazzo Ducale e alla Cadoro. So there is a line of continuity with the past and the tradition which is preserved in this new Venice built within Venice by the futurist Studentaccio. But this is just a general overview, and much more can be said about the novel, but I leave the floor to Professor Valesio, and I thank you for the attention.
Let me go quickly through the thanks that you and the pleasure. Stefano Albertini, first of all, the impresario of the series, and half the redazione of IPR, the Italian Poetry Review, is present here. Patrizio, first of all, I'd like to call my confrère, if you allow me this French word, the associate director of the journal, Alessandro Polchi, Steve Baker, who has began the daunting task of translating Venezianella Studentaccio in English, and it will be quite a challenge. And I'm very glad to be with my old friend Jeffrey Schnapp and with Jennifer Scappettone, whom I remember from UCLA. I first knew her as a poet, and now I am enlarging my acquaintance with her scholarship. Patrizio has given the basic structure of the novel. I would like to take a perhaps larger view and read a page from it, which I think will show, the page is, I'm now no Carmelo Bene, but it will show that this in fact is a poetic novel or a poetic, really it's a poem in prose, it's a prose poem, so I think we're perfectly within the theme of the series. And I would like to add, however, that the irreverent battuta about Venice that let's put it back on the cover, is not uttered by Studentaccio, but by his enemy, Tenebro, the name is indicative. And Studentaccio jumps at his throat with this phrase, and they almost kill each other, so there is quite a dialectic view of Venice in the novel. Well, two or three words. I try to follow some schema because I tend to digress, as many of you know. But first, the two pages that Patrizio has shown are just a little part of what we fought with for days and nights, the manuscript, I mean. The fascination for me of philology is not so much a sense of discovery in the sense that there was something that suddenly came out of it, Latin or something like that, but the reperception of an object. And it was for me a great experience when we began tentatively to realize that these two very bad, very badly typed TypeScript full of errors, very difficult, of course, to distinguish from typically futurist neologisms. When we decided, and this is a decision that is not simply materially based, we decided that it was a great novel. That was the discovery. And when finally the manuscript came to light and we started working on it, it confirmed our idea. It's a dialectic move. If you don't decide that what you are going to spend days and nights on deciphering all these little squirrely notes is worth it, you don't do it. So my claim is very strong. And of course I'll refer you to the novel prove it mathematically. This is one of the great experimental novels of the 20th century that we have in front of us, and it, such should be read and studied. So much for the fact that philology, in fact, immediately goes into, there is no boundary that I can see between philology and maybe philosophy, in a sense. I mean, the general view of an aesthetic object, which is in this case is the novel. The lack of these boundaries to me is good. I'm not upset by it, on the contrary. What does it all mean, though? I mean, I think Patrizio explained very well what this novel is about. I'd like to show, with the help of Marinetti, in fact, that in this late stage of his production, in this absolutely astonishing Annus Mirabilis, 1943-1944, which is also an Annus Horribilis in the history of Italy, as we all know. But Marinetti is extremely and brilliantly productive. This is just one of the things he wrote, as Patrizio hinted at. But this, I use the word palinode, as you know, the move by which a poet, having written an invectiva against somebody, takes it back and writes a contrary poem. The famous example, as you know, is the poet who wrote a whole poem against Helen of Troy. He was promptly blinded for his impertinence, and he dictated a poem that sang the praises of Helen, and sight was restored. It's a legend, but it's interesting. There is a palinode here. Marinetti rediscovered the beauty, the lyrical beauty of Venice. In fact, Venezianella contains the most seductive and fascinating images of a gondola I ever read. So he went back to his original idea. But again, taking a broad review, why is this novel so important? It is, as I say, an experimental novel. It has to be read, it must be read, on the background of the great experimental prose in English and French. Marinetti did not know English. He had a very prejudiced, I think, wrong opinion of Joyce. He didn't know, as far as I know, Gertrude Stein, but Gertrude Stein was aware of the futurist. But actually, this novel, to be understood, to be felt, should be read on the background of Joyce and Gertrude Stein, of prose writers like this. It's not simply that the punctuation is missing, it is a whole texture of association that deserves to be put on the background of the great experimental prose of Europe. Now, I said, and I think I don't have to explain why 1943-1944 is an annus horribilis for Italy. I'm thinking, Marinetti helped me to think, Marinetti, the immersion in the details of the text and the long discussion, which at times became almost a dissent with Patrizio, but we managed to keep everything in boundaries about what that this word means, and let us see the squiggle which makes the P is similar to that we make the G, and so forth and so on. What was at stake, it seems to me, was nothing less than a certain image of the Novecento. I use Italian word for it. The Novecento, as you know, has been authoritatively defined as the shortest century. It's the short century. I would like to say that in a certain sense it is a long century, because we're still not out of it. Non abbiamo ancora fatto I conti con Novecento. We still don't fully understand what it was. One of the paradoxes of the century, it seems to me, and many people, including Jeffrey Schnapp, are working on this, is that the century in which Italy invented one of the two totalitarian dictatorship, and was also a battleground for the other one, black and the red, in Italy, a fight that to a certain extent may be still, although not bloody forms, persists. On this background of totalitarianism, probably an Italian semi-invention, but on this background, Italy produced, arguably, it has been argued, I didn't argue it myself, one of the basic achievements in the visual arts in Europe and internationally, and I would suggest one of the most extraordinary corpuses of poetry in Europe. Now, you can say, well, of course, that was the translation of what I'm saying would be to go straight beyond those, the anni horribilis, to Montale, Ungaretti, and so forth and so on. But this is not satisfactory, really, because what still Italy has to come to Italian literary criticism, unlike Italian historical criticism. Italian historical criticism has long ago come to terms with the great richness, the dramatic but authentic modernism that exists in Italy between 1925 and 1945. What we still have to come to terms with is the literature, the beauty of the poetry that explains the poetry of the second half of the century, we are at the cerniera, at the joint between the two of the century. We still have to fully accept and realize the indispensability, I mean indispensable in the technical terms, in the terms in which without, I don't know, without Picasso we can't explain contemporary painting, something like that. Without D'Annunzio and Marinetti, where rivals, friends, Marinetti clear anxiety of influence about D'Annunzio. Of course, when I say that Venezianella in Studentaccio is a poetic novel, or a poetic, a poem in prose, of course, what looms large in the background that Marinetti is fully aware of it is D'Annunzio's Notturno. So, I mean, you know, but they were friends. They are the indispensable poets of contemporary, they're indispensable for the contemporary Italian poetry, as Montale, admirer of D'Annunzio, and Saba, admirer of D'Annunzio, knew very well. The lyrical strain in Italian poetry is still in debt to D'Annunzio. The experimental strain in Italian poetry is still in debt to Marinetti, although Sanguinetti and others circumvented it, and funnily enough, to avoid certain ideological connotation connected to Marinetti, went to Pound, which is a strange way of solving the problem. We have to accept, to understand this complicated genealogy. But it is a genealogy, and if one looks with calm and detachment at the poetical record, I think one see an uncanny continuity. I don't know of any experimental novel in Italy, I think the Novissimi are not, that is certainly not the strong point, the novel. I think one has to think of Garda, or perhaps of a totally different and more rational novel, but equally daring and risk-taking, which is Petrolio by Pasolini. I know five or six novels who take these risks. There are, of course, novels who play on the Venetian description, on the necessity of rewriting Venice in a very different way, and the most well-known, certainly you have already thought of it, is Calvino, Le Città Invisibili, which is not an experimental novel. It is, in fact, another belletristic experiment, in my humble opinion. But there are very few dispensable novels about Venice, and Marinetti is one of them. I said a palinode. It is, in fact, an experimental love letter to Venice, no longer the Venice of moon, light, and so forth, or summertime that Philip Catherine Hepburn, but yes, there is a loving relationship to the city. This is a guy who is practically confined to his home, which looks over the Canal Grande, is too sick to move around very, very much. So his Venice is constructed of dialogues with his friends, in the transparency, so to speak, nella filigrana of Venezianella Studentaccio, there are some of the important figures of late futurism, Acquaviva, Crali, and so forth and so on. And he listens to dialogues around Venice, as we all know. It's a great salotto. This is an exact commonplace in which at night you can hear the conversation of everybody around you because there are no cars. So he describes this, he reproduces, he transfigures this kind of conversation. Venezianella, I think, is an extraordinary figure. In a certain sense, and at a certain level, she is even too easily seen as an allegory of Venice. But she's a very much alive, she's a charming woman, and the touch of feels the charm of Venezianella very much. At the same time, she's evanescent, she's never there, she's always somewhere else. And at the end, try to read, her voice comes from heaven. I don't know of any other way to put it. Her voice comes from heaven. Marinetti, in my opinion, this is a long discussion and we will come back to it with Jeffrey and with Jennifer. Marinetti was a great poet of matter, physical matter, but I don't think he was ever a materialist. He was a kind of savage spiritualist from the beginning. The extra, the important turning point of Venezianella and Studentaccio, but also of other texts like L'Aeropoema di Gesù, the title, typically Marinetti. The turning point of these last years is that it turns to a more clearly transcendent view of the world, and a more clearly religious one, which should not really surprise people who went beyond the anti-clerical rhetoric, certainly deeply felt by Marinetti, but anti-clericalism and anti-religiosity is very different. Even the novel is often quoted as typical of Marinetti's total rejection of Christianity, L'Aeroplano del Papa, in which he imagined the Pope, it's interesting, recent event, the Pope picked up from the Vatican, brought around on a plane. It's a lyrical description of Italy. There's no animals there. It's lyrical. It's a surrealistic idea that is entertained
from La Dolce Vita.
As such.
Huh? From La Dolce Vita.
Yes,
it's Jesus in the
Papa. So, in this text, he clearly goes toward what I think Jeffrey calls strong transcendence. He distinguishes it. Explain later about strong and weak transcendence. It's a spiritual transcendence. It's a sense of the transcendent. That Studentaccio is more earthy and Venezianella is more spiritual, but they both are a complicated and very human, too human, to use Nietzsche, couple. They are a very human couple, but they have deep spiritual and philosophical concern. They debate. What is Venice? What is beauty? And so forth and so on. And I think that's one of the fascinating elements of the novel. I'd like to make an experiment because, you know, one speaks in abstract. Patrizio read some of the most beautiful phrases as quotes. I'd like to make an experiment and we'll see if it works. To show what I'm talking about rather than telling you about it, I like to try and read, it should take less than 5 minutes, the two final pages of the novel. We are at the end of this story. There are a series of short chapters. This is the last chapter is called Vaganti aeropitture del teatro aereo, typical title of the capitolo, because it doesn't really explain what the capitolo is all about, but it gives you a sense of what his images are. And these are the two final pages in which first, it appears that Venezianella and Studentaccio are getting married, but then, in fact, Venezianella disappears, and she speaks from the sky and blesses the whole enterprises. The novel finishes. The typescripts were so bad that some people thought that this was an incomplete novel. No, it is a complete novel, but the finale is not totally clear. There is, in some sense, a new Venice, and Venezianella is hovers about it, blessing. I can't find any other word for it. That's it. O sorridente chioma di un mandorlo che irrora di petali la grata del parlatorio a contrabbasso lagunare, aiutami a decifrare l'ora inquieta in cui perfeziono Venezianella e Studentaccio. Nessuno può dirmi d'onde viene questo scricchiolare di lavagne levigate da vischiosi interrogativi. Verbalizzerò intanto per bene la blandizia d'aria soave in bocca dell'oe, oe, ae, ae, del gondoliere che scantona un canaletto con lo sceric della pala del remo contagocce di silenzi sceric, sceric, fendiguarisci, fendiguarisci. Fiorire di zigrinanti zigzag ballerini sulle chiglie catramose delle peate di frutta carbone scaricare profumando di carnosa succosa serenità il canal grande. Il giocattolesco bianco-nero caffè dell'universo della piazza della chiesa San Giovanni e Paolo mal contiene i bronchi spumanti di Mario Menin e poi. O miei simpatici lettori, tengo a ricordarvi che lo svenimento del sole invidioso della luna in una di queste città candite nelle spezie del passato suscita un'ora sibillina di vaporanti decotti su fuocherello boschivo con filtri, lambicchi e penombre complottatrici. Non di meno il sole è festoso quanto il tondo cappello di paglia di Firenze di una bionda bambina forestiera. Venezia si ricesella tutta da sé nello zaffiro, con riflessi vogliosi di risuonare fin nei timpani delle nuvole. Gondoliere filarmonico, now is a gondolier, that's a palinode, if ever was one, Gondoliere filarmonico, io svogliatamente remo, mi curo soltanto di scartare gli opulenti broccati verdi degli strascichi che ingombrano le ombre lunghe del sontuoso ricevimento solare. Più invidioso che raggiante ricevimento da maschiaccio virile figlio di agricoltori, il sole. Non può pretendere gli onori devoluti al pallore imperlato della luna, consanguina di Leopardi, Baudelaire, Mallarmé, abituata a vivere in alcove soffici di versi preziosi. Lo ripete una mano d'ebano che liscia, cicatrizza ogni liquida nequizia. Gondoliere filarmonico, faccio gemere col remare cadenzato un armonioso liuto di sposini a chiavi e corde intrecciate. Se si coricano sembrano due feriti d'amore in barella navigante. Nel rialzarsi scottano sudando come due uova pasquali in buon'aria insalatina. I loro volti splendidi confetti natalisti sono decisi a farsi succhiare dalle tremule labbra della prima stella. And so forth, this is clearly poetry, whatever it is. And in fact, one doesn't even to understand every single Italian word. And in fact, Marinetti would not have demanded this. So far, just let go with the flow. At a certain point, the last apparition is the appearance of the lions. It is a court. Appena rivoltato una coltre bruna, sboccia un baffuto di bragia corteo di leoni. Sono di marmo, ma vivi e palpitanti di maestosa conquista nell'approdare sulla piazza San Giovanni e Paolo, tutta dorata di attesa come il deserto nativo. It's constantly playing about his birth in North Africa, in Alexandria and Venice. It goes with total disinvoltura between the two spots. Li comanda a zampa alzata un leone sahariano, fulvo, chiuto da diamanti neri con in bocca una lampada accesa. Nel crescente accavallarsi di tenebre incuriosite, tutti ne ammettono lo strambo fulgore senza spiegarselo. Domenicani bianchi imbavagliano frettolosamente l'anima ruggente dell'organo. Ora mi spiego lo scricchiolare di catene simile a quello delle rose lave dell'Etna. Arcigno rumore di marcia che si spoffa in uno strame materasso di 100 belle veneziane prostrate faccia contro un pavimento di capigliature peccatrici. La navata, il stocchi of church, San Giovanni e Paolo, la navata con la sua crociera firmamentale invoca la preghiera degli alati leoni docili e severi domati dal buio, ma terremotata la parete di sinistra sganghera fuori monumenti equestri, urne funerari, alcove marmoree di dogaresse a guisa di pulpiti insorti ed è la tomba di Jacopo dei Cavalli che aizza a gesticolare e imprecare. Vili, vili, vi dichiariamo vili perché lasciaste pietrificare la vostra forza dalla vanità e mal ci consigliaste che per sembrar leoni ci assopimmo in forme lapide. O leoni, sbranate il fangoso passato che risale. That's in futurist invective. But then it doesn't end like this. Then the bells come out. Turn, I think, rather important. Una campana ammonisce. Danno, danno, sì, danno vi verrà. O leoni, se disobbedite a noi, campane, che siamo il buon pane dello spazio affamato. Allora una melodiosa voce, disse Svenezianella, allora una melodiosa voce fattasi donna blu-rosa, raggio lievemente adorno di voluttuose curve nascenti già svanite mentre regnano ampi gli sguardi di Zaffiro Venezianella, the last word is her, and she says, il pensiero che sopravvive alla fine del corpo e alla pietrificazione piace a Dio. E tu, caro studentaccio, mi risentirai fusa con la cuspide della nuova Venezia, costruita da te e nelle sinuose labbra del fulgido portasigarette d'oro che mi regalasti. It's a mixture of mundane and spiritual. I think it's, if I have an idea of modern spirituality, is this. This is the last phrase of the novel, Patrizio at the first, and I rest my case.
Okay, so I'm just going to spend a second here setting up. And if I can, at the same time, thank Patrizio, Paolo Valesio, and Stefano Albertini for letting me be a part it's on the other side.
Oops.
Can we maybe switch
chairs
just
over here?
For now?
Yeah, sure.
Futurism, the new generation has. So.
Well, we are very happy that you can make it flying from Chicago.
Flying from Chicago today. So I've been awaiting the release of this novel since I met Professor Valesio in California when I was a graduate student, very anxiously, and it's a pleasure to discuss it in the context of work that I've been doing over the past 13 or years or so on the topic of modernism in Venice. So what I'm going to do is set this remarkable Aero novel or Aero poem in the context of a tradition of literature that is grappling with the desire for a kind of radiant presence. When F.T. Marinetti and comrades airbombed crowds arriving from the Lido's new beach resorts from the clock tower of St. Mark's Square with 800,000 copies of Contro Venezia Passatista, symbolically hijacking the timekeeping of the campanile being pathetically reconstructed across the plaza and ushering the burgeoning leisure class into a new accelerated tempo, they defined the futurist mission in unprecedentedly concrete terms of urban planning. The document, which I'm placing here in translation for any of you who don't know it, calls on Venetians to destroy the decrepit curves of the city and to erect the imposing geometry of an industrial port in their place, sealing off Venice's signature influx from afar phantasmatically, to make of the Adriatic Sea a Gran Lago Italiano. Efforts to modernize the city had been debated locally for two decades, and from 1917 forward, capitalist impresarios were to develop the port of Marghera as the lung of Venetian modernity. Yet the performative force of the futurist tractates does more to drive Venice into the rhetoric and epos of the modern than any piecemeal effort of modernization. The Nuova Venezia, wrought imaginatively by the futurist polemic, struck such a resounding chord that today's Venetians view the port and petrochemical plants as Marinetti's dream realized. Launched on the heels of Daniel Burnham's 1909 plan of Chicago, the futurist scheme to cicatrize Venice ushers the 19th century urban ideal of Haussmann's Paris being implemented internationally into a cityscape particularly unaccommodating to such blueprints, as well as to later fascist campaigns of sventramento in the service of an aesthetic program of Romanità. Despite piecemeal reclamation projects for easier circulation and the 1932 construction of the automotive causeway connecting Venice with the mainland, speed and noise would be symbolically held at bay at the confines of the Venetian lagoon. Venice's formal and therefore symbolic resistance to designs along the lines of Marinetti's has rendered it a point of reference for those seeking to delineate and explore the conceptual borders of the modern, both early and late. It was in relation to the 1980 Venice Biennale, the world's first independent international architecture exhibition, credited with introducing postmodernism to a broader public for the first time, that Jürgen Habermas was compelled to define and defend the rationalism of aesthetic modernity. Anachronistic Venice formed an apt environment for an exhibition that represented the sacrifice of the modern tradition, as Habermas would lament. Titled The Presence of the Past and installed in the Arsenale, which was open to the public for the first time in 800 years, the biennial curated by Paolo Portoghesi emblematized the dawning of a movement that would rummage through the spectral forms of history. The central exhibition transformed the Corderie into a Strada Novissima, which we see here, composed of 20 facade fantasies, designed by leading architects from around the world and constructed to scale by the studios of Cinecittà. Pastiches of mock spoliated columns, masonry types, and entrance thresholds realized the wistful reawakening of the street as a rebuke to the heroic modernist enterprise. Habermas opened his seminal acceptance speech for the Adorno Prize with a poignant suspicion of this, quote, avant-garde of reversed fronts that sacrificed the tradition of modernity in order to make room for new historicism. On this occasion, Habermas famously set himself against the Frankfurt School's critique of enlightenment. Against the new historicism on display in Venice, Habermas identified in the modern impulse, quote, the longing for an undefiled, immaculate, and stable present. It is not by chance that both Marinetti in 1910 and Habermas in 1980 were drawn to define the modern through and against Venice. Modernism had always been subject to stress in this place, a city that offers, in the words of UAV architectural historian Manfredo Tafuri, a subtle challenge that affects the very presuppositions of modernity. Any quest to usher the city of lagoons into a purely present tense or even to harmonize its histories is frustrated by the mediation of centuries of inscription on the one hand, and on the other by structural features of the cityscape itself, a topographical ambiguity or amphibiousness that retains natural features associated with the primordial, and an architectonic obliquity and digression that thwart any Cartesian viewpoint onto the whole. Marinetti's ruthless 1910 scheme and its reprisal in the bombardments of Ricostruire l'Italia con architettura futurista Sant'Elia reflected a pervasive frustration with Venice, its resistance to sintesi, visible, spatial, and social. Jacopo de Barbari had fashioned a monumental panorama of the archipelago as early as 1500, gathering the work of many surveyors to manufacture a composite bird's eye view. Yet to those unpossessed of such an aid, the labyrinth deflects synthesizing gazes, continuing to bend at odds against the modern French ideal of a direct legibility of space and masses. Marinetti yokes its spatial obscurity anxiously to amorous channels in disprising the city who, like a procuress wearing a pesante mantiglia di mosaici, insists a offrirci donne velate ad ogni svolto crepuscolare dei canali. A labyrinth could accommodate insurrection more easily, as the forces of Paris realized, at least through the 19th century. The crucial Venetian uprising against Austro-Hungarian rule in 1848 had ultimately to be suppressed by an Austrian invention in aerial combat, bombs dropped from balloons. Oh, I see that it's here. This is a map of the bombardments of Venice in 1915. Venice's age-old protection by a shallow lagoon rendered it necessary for Austrians to attack the city from the air in 1915 as in the 19th century. They forced Italy's admission into the Great War with strikes upon the arsenal and followed with 39 additional air raids. These circumstances rendered Venice a seductive locus for the eventual evolution of aeropoesia, one that could distance the cultural lexicon of air travel from the archaizing strain of D'Annunzio's aerial rhetoric. From Venice, Marinetti undertook an elaborate revision of D'Annunzio's passeist Venetian narratives of water and fire in the form of an aerotext that renders the undersea itself and its decorative elaboration glass, a medium of social rejuvenation. The female colossus of glass in Venezianella e Studentaccio revises and invests with power the fonda siècle forgery of a woman identified with Venice in modern Italian literature, Perdita Foscarina, compliant love object of D'Annunzio's Il Fuoco, cast as lagoon matter to be shaped by her paramour, the artisan or lord of fire. I have to go back. Marinetti's act of rewriting can be seen as the capstone of an Oedipal struggle against the symbolism of D'Annunzio and his contemporaries, though we will see that post-romantic Venice as matrix box both nostalgic fantasies of return to a Gothic order, as reflected in John Ruskin's Stones of Venice here, and fantasies of linear progression that disavow their romantic precursors. John Ruskin, first and most vehement to refute the romantic legacy of Venice and to produce non-linear histories in the process, admits in the Stones of Venice, 1851 to 53, that it can be tempting to disavow the depredations of modern Venice. The construction of a railway bridge in 1846 made the fabled transition from land to lagoon barely perceptible, so that, quote, the noble landscape of approach to her can now be seen only by a glance as the engine slackens its rushing on the iron line. Ruskin argues implicitly that we too must approach the city through new channels, like it or not. Many a hurried traveler will be inclined to disguise what is discordant, he says, in this scene, but he grants no permission to such obfuscations. Quote, impotent feelings of romance may indeed gild but never save the remains of those mightier ages, and they must be torn away from the magnificent fragments if we would see them. The Venice of modern fiction and drama is a thing of yesterday, a stage dream with which the first ray of daylight must dissipate into dust. If we are to discern anything at all in Venice, we must emancipate the city in fragments from the lugubriously sentimental stage dream of romanticism. True engagement obliges us to view magnificent Venice as a complex of objects, however damaged, in the brutal light of the present. Only then can these objects become touchstones of a world that would counter our own. In inventing the avant-garde half a century later, Marinetti echoes Ruskin's call for the merciless illumination of Venice, calling upon citizens to uccidere il chiaro di luna, kill the moonlight that pervades popular representations, though he appends an imperative to fill the canals with the ruins of the leprous old palaces themselves rotten with romanticism. Venga finalmente il regno della divina luce elettrica a liberare Venezia dal suo venale chiaro di luna. The careers of these demagogic figures could not seem more opposed to one another. In fact, Ruskin lamented the city's introduction of gaslight in 1845, while Marinetti blamed Ruskin for having singularly developed the obsessive cult of our past in Europe. However dissimilar, these authors pursue a common end which appropriates the rhetoric of enlightenment and becomes central to the scheme of modernism. By striking Venice with the light of day and electricity, respectively, they seek to collapse romantic distance from the place, to regard the city as material, as matter, however distressed, in the present tense. Their aspiration toward objectivity aims to restore to the discordant material at hand a radiant presence, even if their hopes and methods for arriving at presence are diametrically opposed. The aspiration to revive Venice by subjecting romantic falsehoods to the light of the current day has yielded a century and a half of aesthetic experimentation, whose struggle deserves its own history in the its own chapter in the history of modernism. For insofar as modernity is defined by the myth of a radical break with the past, Venice persists as an exemplary aberration. It becomes the locus par excellence in which to contend with ghosts that foil the quest for presence Habermas locates at the heart of modernism, and ultimately to recover a vitally nonlinear form of historicity, wherein the pressure to recuperate the past for present purposes gives rise to countless filtrations and detours. The Nuovissima Venezia built by Venezianella and Studentaccio by amalgamating the mosaics of the New Venice, not only at the level of diegetic narration, but at the level of poesis itself, encapsulates these contradictions. Coming to structural terms with the city's aggregative, collaborative foundation, Marinetti subverts the figure ground rapport of his avant-garde designs on the city. The text activates this plan implicitly by a privileging of lagunar matrix, the source of glass facture, over heroic figure in descriptive and narrative prose blocks. Passages accrete sumptuous detail paratactically in syntactically tenuous clusters set off against bouts of casual dialogue. Futurist words may have been freed by a plane's whirling propeller, but they are also freed in this text from any airborne surveyor. The new Venetian urbanism will emerge on the heels of design's detachment from its author's feet. So here, I'm not actually going to go into this, but I just want to show you a few images of the kinds of topoi that Marinetti is working with in designing, through this text, a Nuova Venezia made by futurist glassblowers. Marinetti redirects D'Annunzio's fuoco toward a stalwart new Venice of blown glass and crystal, invested with the energy of ingenuous invention envisioned by Venezianella herself. In so doing, he revises D'Annunzio's unidirectional, hieratic relation between woman and man, creator and created. The text draws on historical forms and local materials while resisting the magnificent stasis of D'Annunzio's ghostly creations. The unruly excess of his Aero novel's convulsive, polychromatic glass city constitutes a totality that is both fragile and implosive. In Venezianella, glass of beguiling, changeful hues filters views, providing no transparent threshold of incorporation. It composes not an abstract body politic, but a female body, virile yet invested in decor. Venezianella invests glass with the capacity to produce passionately, apocalyptically eclectic visions of social synthesis. That glass should constitute the medium of Venice's reconstruction is rich with contradiction. So here are some of the glass monuments that Marinetti may have been thinking of. The Crystal Palace, the plate glass skyscrapers typical of the Chicago School. He's working with, this is a map clearly made for tourists going to Murano, whose glass works had been criticized in recent times for, you know, basically producing tchotchkes, but that were trying to be revitalized as a means of sort of gaining some economic independence. He may also have been thinking of Bruno Taut, the glass house, and Schierbart's glass architecture. But the most famous building in of the time would have been Giuseppe Terlani's Casa del Fascio in Como, which was, however, very much a building in which the transparency of glass was supposed to create this sort of bonding between the populace and the regime. And what we see in this text is altogether different from that. So we can talk about that later. I just want to end by just saying a little bit, just concluding with some thoughts on this, the radically anachronistic complex made of Cadoro, of Basilica di San Marco, this sort of unruly architecture of Venezianella as Colossus. Marinetti's revised syntax of the new no longer clears away the forms that encumber the modern totality. It is radically anachronistic. Studentaccio intuits that Venezianella would like to be freed of all past memories in the quote that Patrizio read before. But once la tua scultura smisuratamente ingigantita, and this necessitates stylistic expansiveness, a recuperatively eclectic new identity. Venezianella e Studentaccio deviates into narrative modes that dilate, multiply, hone in on time, amplifying the text's self-reflexive generic instability. Questo ero romanzo, ero poema, poco si cura del tempo e dello spazio. In the epic war over a new Venice, battles last half a century each, and nine generations of futurists must fight off troops of cesspools. Along the way, the epic digresses into the fable and into self-reflexive aesthetic commentary, mediated on stylistic, generic, and represented material fronts. Venezianella engages history as an amassment of filters, blockages, and encrustations through which the living must bore in order to renew society. Writing from within the tenuous asylum of a Venice hemmed in by war, Marinetti is assailed with the tortuous roots of cultural inheritance. His late text expresses that a new day for the city and or the nation can only be erected by navigation through preceding forms and teeming residua. Out of endless battle comes volatile amalgamation with the past. I think this text shows that Venice does not expire over the centuries of its surface abjection, nor over the decades separating futurism's founding and termination. It persists as a site of influx and efflux that remains steadfastly Venetian, forcing incursions into it to change their ways or channels, literally. As such, it resists the dyads of future and past, implicit in what Adorno called the fatally rectilinear succession of victory and defeat, forcing authors to contend with, quote, the waste products and blind spots that have escaped the dialectic, unquote, in a vengeful obsolescence. Thanks.
Grab a copy of this. First of all, obviously, thank you to our hosts, Stefano in particular. It's delightful to see you after all these years, and two old friends and new friends as well here at the podium, the figurative podium at least. I'm going to, in a sense, not so much reflect directly on the this, I think, fascinating Marinettian unpublished work, a work that really is a kind of capstone, as has been suggested in all of the presentations, of a career dedicated to bombing and dynamiting the past, and where the past recurs with a kind of obsessive frequency that suggests not more than just an ambivalence, a fundamental challenge that I think is faced in all efforts at radical renewal in one form or another. ModernItalia is a book, it's a collection of essays expertly and splendidly edited by Francesca Santovetti, who's here with us, who wrote a brilliant introduction to the volume, who I wanted to acknowledge in particular, is a book that begins with futurism and comes back to futurism with a kind of obsessiveness of its own. And that obsessiveness is, in a sense, very much informed by a theme that's been, I think, central to this conversation from the beginning, which is the way in which Venice, the figure of Venice, this figure of in a sense, everything that stands in the way of Marinetti's project of renewal, the cultural revolution that Marinetti and futurism will bring forward, not only appears as a necessary enemy, but also as a past that somehow must be absorbed and reinvented and reborn and resuscitated and revivified, whether it's in a kind of palinodic mode of recognizing its strength, acknowledging its vitality, paradoxically, even as it's been declared moribund, or in through acts of demolition that give rise to acts of construction. So Venice is a particular kind of an intensifying lens within the Italian context, which is a context which, as I'm going to suggest by reading a couple of passages from different essays that are about different aspects of 20th century cultural history in Italy, for me is itself an intensifying lens on some fundamental kind of core paradoxes of processes of cultural modernization. ModernItalia, as the title suggests, is itself a futurist neologism, quite deliberately so. It takes advantage of the fact that the word for modernity overlaps with the beginning of the word for the nation's modern nation state, Italy, right? But a nation state which bears already in its own name the kind of freight of its own history, its association with prior cultural epics. It represents a spectrum of work that extends back as early as an essay that was published in 1984 all the way to 2009, so it's a very broad spectrum. But as I said, futurism is certainly one of the core features of it. But futurism is like a kind of hum that hovers in the background of a series of other episodes. But all of those episodes have at their core this problem of what to do with the past. A past that either will not go away or that keeps on coming back in forms that have to somehow be controlled and shaped and given a set of meanings that involve modernization. So in a sense, it's a book that looks at it from a variety of different angles at the rather non-linear, sort of the zigzagging path of modernization that characterizes Italian culture, with one step forward, one step sideways, one step backward, this constant conversation, dialectic, haunting of elements of the past, whether it's classical remains or it's the architecture of the 19th century. And the way in which it constantly is informing a conversation about the future, about going beyond that that past. The book is built in just very, its broad kind of architectural kind of confines are determined by two large thematic areas. The first is called Normal Anomalies. It's a series of essays that try to think about what appear to be anomalous features of the Italian Italian rhetorics of radical transformation and modernization. I'm going to talk about one in particular and read from it. But within that framework, the case studies are a treatise by Marinetti, which I'm going to read from in a moment, which is from 1916. It's La religione morale della velocità, the religion morality of speed. The question that I address in that essay is, how can speed be a religion morality? Isn't the overcoming of religion the key operation that's being carried out in these rhetorics of radical rupture with the past? With how do we, I mean, this is a theme that Paolo Valesio has brought up in his own presentation, I think, richly, in a richly textured way. How did these forms of transcendence, these rhetorics of going beyond the human, couple with a kind of radical call to attend to matter, to the physicality of the world, to everything but what appears at first glance, at least, to be transcendent or to transport us to some other realm? The second essay in that section is on Julius Evola, the leading Italian Dadaist in his late teens and early 20s, and who then goes on to become a metaphysician, one of the most puzzling but I think intriguing figures of the 1930s, associated with spiritualized notions of racism to the right or to the left of the fascist mainstream, depending on how you define it. Later an author of books on yoga and sexuality. Certainly one of the few philosophical figures associated with the radical right in Italy, who survives the end of World War II, never had a fascist party card, was actually rejected largely by major segments of the fascist establishment, but embraced by others. A very complex, problematic figure, but whose point of departure is Dadaism. Dada as a practice, a radically nihilistic practice, both in the realm of painting and in the realm of poetics, the two very tightly woven together. I look at a couple of other examples. Piero Portaluppi, one of the deans, literally the dean of the 20th century architectural establishment. I don't know Portaluppi well. The dean because he was the dean of the Milan Polytechnic during the era when many of the major architects who defined Italian architecture in the post-war period were trained. But a totally eclectic figure, fascinated by Baroque forms of art ornament, by the cult of luxury, a rationalist fascinated with precious materials, a kind of living contradiction in terms. And finally, and I will read briefly from this section, Giuseppe Terragni, the architect of the Casa del Fascio, perhaps the greatest, certainly the greatest Italian architect of the first half of the 20th century, the leading proponent of rationalism in Italy, who took on in a series of projects the problem of funerary monuments. What does a modernist monument look like? A monument crafted in an architectural language that is about everything but ruminating, reflecting, obsessing about the past. What does a fresh start look like in the form of a monument, a marker that's about memory? And last but not least, there's an essay on experiments with the total theater that look back to medieval mystery theater as a model, but also to contemporary Soviet political theater. And there's then a series of brief interludes, one on the iconography of workers' bodies in Italy and beyond. The second one on a puzzling portrait by de Chirico. It's a puzzling portrait, for one thing, because it's the first portrait in the history of Western portraiture where the subject being portrayed is wearing sunglasses. The title of the work is a premonitory portrait of Guillaume Apollinaire. Now, probably applied, the title was applied post factum because de Chirico, who was I would say famous would be an understatement for falsifying titles as well as dates of his work, of course, had the advantage of knowing when he assigned that title that Apollinaire was killed in World War, would be a victim of World War I. So the portrait, which was painted before, becomes a portrait that prophetically proclaims the subject putatively being depicted in this sort of prophetic mode as fated to die. The concluding major section of the book is entitled Craft and Industry, and it looks at a series of different examples of four areas of practice where we see, I think, what is the defining paradox of much of Italian industrial culture, which is the persistence of a past that assumes the form of craft culture, of certain practices that industrialism pushed out of the way in other industrial contexts, but that in Italy persist and then come to be coupled tightly with forms of industrial practice. The most famous example is in the fashion industry, examples like Ferragamo, the rise of Ferragamo in the 1930s, where we have a kind of craft-based production set of practices, skills associated with the hand fabrication of shoes that are reinterpreted for industrial type production for the American market, initially, in the case of Ferragamo, not so much for the Italian market. So we have these peculiar comminglings of cultures of industry and cultures of craft. And I think this is a defining attribute of the Italian economy of the second half of the 20th century. And it's one that's totally born in the fascist period with a whole series of values that come out of the culture of autarky, the privileging of poor materials, weak materials, not mainstream industrial materials, as the kind of foundations for the creation of a culture of that's both luxurious, that reestablishes certain kinds of forms of luxury, but in terms that belong to the era of industry, the era of the masses. And I look at one example from Marinetti's own world, one example from Bruno Munari, a kind of second generation futurist who then transforms himself in the course of the 1930s and 1940s into a figure who will be really a leading advocate both in the concrete art movement but also more broadly in areas of design education, reform, a prodigious experimenter with all kinds of media. Munari is a figure whom I'm continuing to work on, but this was an attempt to tell the story of Munari's work as a commercial artist, as a layout artist, an art director for an aviation magazine, which was the official fascist magazine of aviation in the 1930s, Ala d'Italia, but was read by a mass audience. Aviation was a mass sort of theme in the 1930s. And then finally, two kind of outlier figures, Malaparte, Curzio Malaparte's interest in shaping books in his own image, this kind of denunciant obsession that Malaparte inherited that brought him to torture his publishers. I mean, Valecchi is the most famous one, to create books that he imagined as this kind of direct projection of his own poetic project, the sort of image that he was trying to craft his own career in terms of. And finally, the story concludes with Henry Furst, who is literally a kind of bridge across the Atlantic. Furst was an American-born figure kicked out of Yale as an undergraduate for all kinds of scurrilous activities, went to Italy, ended up as one of the few American members of the March on Fiume, He became D'Annunzio's propaganda minister, whatever that means, during the occupation. Was a flamboyant homosexual, part of a circle, the yoga circle that Guido Keller, some other really fascinating figures were part of in the D'Annunzian entourage. He goes on to become one of the only American members of the Italian fascist fascist party, translates bidirectionally, but not just bidirectionally, from German into Italian, from Russian, a true polymath, who is most famous for having been the ghostwriter who wrote many of Montale's contributions to the Corriere della Sera, which were signed by Montale, but it has now been revealed actually by Henry I. So I want to just focus on one issue, which is this issue of the transformation of the past, of this kind of presence of the past argument, which Jennifer touched upon, I think, very nicely as well. I mean, I want to start at the beginning, which is to say with the 1909 Futurist Manifesto. I'm going to just read a passage from the first essay in the volume, which I think touches upon this. Then I want to read a brief passage from the essay on Terragni's monument to Roberto Sarfatti, and then close with a brief passage about the role of political exhibitions in Italy, because they all have exactly the same thread, and it's the thread that Venice brings out, kind of crystallizes, but I think is a broader kind of thread within Italian culture as a whole during the course of the 20th century. So whether in Marinetti's 1909 manifesto or in the 1916 elaboration of a religion morality for modern times, or in the vast array of futurist experiments carried out during the fascist decades, speed's triumph is paradoxical, paradoxical by design. On the one hand, speed figures as a new beginning, as the wedge that disjoins the modern era from that which preceded it. It is essential to aggressive movement, feverish insomnia, the race pace, the mortal leap, the slap, and the punch. It gives birth to a new kind of beauty built upon the love of danger, the habit of energy, and fearlessness, which is to say, to a risk-based aesthetics that measures success on the scale not of contemplative pleasure, but of sensory intensity and shock. Speed cuts across all orders of society, bringing together the masters of the era of industry, imagined as drivers seated behind a cosmic steering wheel, with poets charged with the task of augmenting the enthusiastic frenzy of primordial elements, with workers agitated by labor, pleasure, and revolt. In short, speed inaugurates a new cognitive regime and social order, altering everything from forms of pleasure and play to the practical realities of daily life. On the other hand, speed arrives at the end of a lineage at least as ancient as the human imagination. The founding manifesto is forthright as regards this ancient pedigree. In the name of an overcoming of all mythology, it repeatedly invokes classical and Christian myths. We are about to witness the birth of the centaur, and soon the first angels will fly, Marinetti prophesies, as you may recall, in the founding manifesto, alluding to the body-machine fusions of driver and car and pilot and aircraft. The formula is reprised in one of the text's culminating moments, a race car with a hood, with its hood adorned with great pipes, like serpents with an explosive breath, is more beautiful than the victory of the Samothrace, the most famous line from the founding manifesto. Now, this provocation is multi-layered. Yes, the Nike referred to was indeed a fractured object of Passeus worship. And yes, museums are destined for demolition, like such other institutions of memory as libraries and archives. Yet this Nike was also selected as an object of comparison because she is the race car's enemy twin. She's a celestial charioteer descending from the skies to grace the conquering Thracian fleet associated with strength, force, and rivalry, the embodiment of eternal omnipresent speed as it was understood in the pre-industrial era. So even when Marinetti is at the apex of demolishing the past, he chooses not just any target from the past, but a strong target. And it's paradox that is the building block for these operations. It's that paradox, I think, that lies at the core of these that interests me. And it extends as well to the area of architectural practice. We talked a little bit about the case of Venice, but now let's turn to this question of what is a modern monument? What is a monument that doesn't use the language of historical memory to commemorate an event, the past, a person, a passing? The broader concern of this essay, in this case it's an essay entitled The Monument Without Style, is how modern architecture from Adolf Loos, Walter Gropius, and Mies van der Rohe to Terragni, BBPR, Carlos Scarpa, and Aldo Rossi elaborates an anti-monumental monumentalism that weds the rejection of decorativism and the pursuit of mobility, lightness, and functionality with a distinctive imagination that I would not hesitate to refer to as archaeological. At issue is a fundamental and perhaps inescapable paradox, powerfully felt by those for whom, as for Terragni's generation, rationalism and functionalism were understood both as the foundation stones of a new industrial era architecture and as remote expressions of an originary moment within Mediterranean culture. Whether the moment in question is Roman, Etruscan, Minoan, archaic Greek, Assyro-Babylonian, or ancient Egyptian mattered less than the conviction that the monuments of the present and future must somehow coincide with the monuments of a prelapsarian past. The avant-garde's zero degree of representation and construction, its revolts against ornamental forms of historicism, its blank slates and utopic grids, close the door on the past only to reopen it once again in the mode of an archaeology of archaic structures that, however plausibly or improbably, it seeks to unfold within the vibrant electrical aureoles, within vibrant electrical aureoles and glass masks. And the essay goes on to detail how Terragni imagined these monuments made out of heavy stones. In fact, not just heavy stones. Terragni insists in all of his monuments that stones not be just facing, that just wraps an object in the appearance of stone, but that they actually be complete blocks. The monument to Roberto Sarfatti weighed 2 tons, and it is located at the top of a hill where there are no roads, there is no access. These blocks had to be carried at enormous expense from the quarry all the way to this location. So somehow the material is integral to this notion, kind of very crude, archaic notion of the monument. And he imagined, however paradoxical it might seem, these monuments as being like like radio sets, like being these kinds of pure geometrical artifacts that are animated by voices, by electrical forces, by forces, in other words, that. So, I mean, we're back again in a terrain that sounds an awful lot like this concluding passage in Venezianella. I want to close here with just another example, the importance of exhibitions in the culture, not only of Venice, the whole sort of industrial aspect of Venice's construction of a modern identity is closely connected to exhibitions, but also more largely of political and other kinds of exhibitions in Italian culture in the 1930s. Borrowed in part from Germany and from France and from Russia, nonetheless, I think is a really distinctive moment within another iteration of the same problematic. The shift from museums as places of talking about history to exhibitions signals a revolt against historicism and more broadly against the disinterested, analytically grounded positive methodologies upon which historicism relied. The modalities of cultural memory propagated by historical museums were scientific and tendentially elitist. They were founded on incremental narratives of development, on an austere didacticism largely addressed to educated audiences, and on the separation between document, mode of display, and surrounding decor. Political exhibitions instead mirrored the practices of trade fairs and universal expositions. They put themselves forward as impermanent sites of volatile memory, as agitatory instantiations of counter-memory, as museums in motion cast in a populist mode, in which the life-sapping effects of historicism could be shaken off in the service of calls to collective mobilization and myths of redemption or resurrection. And their target audience was neither the aesthete nor the history buff, nor the student or scholar, but rather a distractible, labile, multifaceted creature, mass man, the man of the crowd, whether understood as the contemporary urbanite, the political tourist embarked on a political pilgrimage to the nation's capital, or the foreign tourist brought face to face with an alternately seductive and menacing image of the future in the making. So I think this Venice is not incidental, even though this is not a book about Venice in any way. Venice is really, again, a kind of intensifying crystal, a lens that brings together all of these different kinds of themes that I think very broadly are Italy itself offers an intensifying lens to, in part because of the persistence of the past in the Italian landscape, in part because of the persistence of certain kinds of institutionalizations of the culture of historicism, for a whole series of reasons that continue to resonate, you know, even in the elections of only a few days ago. This past that will not go away, that keeps on coming back, that keeps on being, in a sense, resuscitated for different ends, for conflicting ends almost, is really the thread, I think, that holds together this book as a whole. Thank you.
Non abbiamo molto tempo, no. Però possiamo...
If you have any comment or questions, sì. Even start among yourselves, and then we can...
I have a couple of questions for Patrizio Ceccagnoli or Paolo Valesio about this... a newly published novel by Marinetti, and I was wondering if you have, what is your opinion about the fact that this novel, actually it was known that there was a manuscript, or at least a dactylo script of this novel at the Beinecke Library, so why do you think 60 years had to pass before somebody thought about publishing it? And the second thing is, how do you think this publication is going to change our knowledge or perception of Marinetti, actually.
You first. Well, I just want to make a short premise, because this series of poetry in the city is organized thanks to Stefano Generosity under the auspices of IPR, Italian Poetry Review, which is the journal which hosted actually a preview of the novel in the edition by Amerigo Fabri, who at the time only knew about the existence of the typescript at Beinecke Library. In the process of editing the novel for this publication, Professor and I discovered the existence of a manuscript, which existence we always suspected, because the typescript were coming obviously from a lacking archetype, but only in dealing with our Aspern papers plot, we discover about the manuscript and we change all the parameters for the edition. So that's for the technicality of the traditional text.
The Aspern papers, to me, is the template for this kind of postmodern archival research. Patrizio and I are bound by silence in describing all the little squabbles and rivalries among the heirs of Marinetti. It's a fascinating chapter in itself, and we'll go on dealing with it if we discuss. We have an interesting text in mind that we'd like to edit, but we have to navigate this. And, about the why waiting for, well, there are two considerations. One is, first of all, I really think that texts are lying there. They simply want to be read. I think Alessandro had an experience like this when he found an unpublished, unknown letter by Marsilio Ficino. I don't, you know, you just have to look at them and realize that they are important. It seems, sounds simple, but it's not. In the case of Marinetti, of course, there were a political consideration too. I mean, if memory serves here, Patrizio may be more specific. In his Firenze Biondazzurra, what is the title?
Sposerebbe
futurista morigerato, typically Marinetti title. The proofs were ready in 1942, 1944, and the book had been published a few years ago. Yeah. So we needed a reacceptance of a whole period and a whole author. And by the way, what I like in general about the tone of Jeffrey's book is the cool, the calm, the accepting description, the phenomenology. That's what we need. We need a phenomenology. And I think that's, you know, we have a combination of factors, a certain difficulty in recognizing what is important when it is presented in a sloppy way, in a, like a manner, and other consideration about the author that may act as an obstacle to his acceptance as in the conversation of the intellectual world at this time. In the case of Marinetti, the two things went together. I have a footnote noticing that how much quicker was the posthumous publication of the third novel in Celine trilogy. Mm. And one can speculate on that. Probably the textual structure of the novel was simple. It's more simple to decipher, to put together. There may be other factors, but we have to take into consideration both, as I said before, I said philology, and I exaggerated a bit saying philosophy, in a very broad sense of philosophy. But philology, philosophy, and politics are, seems to me, inextricably mixed, which means that philology, I never understood why philology is considered to be boring. It's like a detective story. And so I think that's goes to answering Davide's. As for the last part of Davide's question, I think, I hope, I bet a part of my life on this, that this is going to change the way we read Marinetti. This is definitely.
May I ask you something, Jennifer? You share with Jeffrey Sneffer this methodological eclecticism, which is very fascinating, and you anticipated something from your book. First of all, when is the book is going to be released, and can you tell us more about it?
I did forget to mention that this is part of a book. It's called Killing the Moonlight, Modernism in Venice, so it takes Marinetti as a central figure in the struggle for a kind of modernism in Venice, and it's forthcoming from Columbia University Press. Either this fall or perhaps spring, because I, like you, have had underscored for me the importance of futurism in railing against those who want to cling to the past, which is to say that there were various complicated permissions issues, and it's taken me like 7 or 8 months to get some of this permission stuff straightened out. And I never had more sympathy for futurism than in the production of this book. But the book basically begins with Ruskin's Stones of Venice, as I anticipated in talking to you, although there is a very long proto-history of engagement, so I have to go back to Byron and Wordsworth and Romanticism, and I have to go much further back, in fact, even to Boccaccio and Petrarch, to understand how Venice has been transmogrified through the centuries and why it is such a central site even into the 21st century. And it basically, it doesn't end in the sense that the last novel is written by Robert Coover in the early 90s, and I discuss it as a kind of hypertext, and that it's treating Venice as a kind of hypertext, because indeed every stone of Venice points to many authors at once and has been inscribed by many authors at once. And the very recent Biennale d'Arte, Bruce Nauman begins the book, a sculpture by Bruce Nauman begins the book.
I have one last question, that it's especially for Paolo and definitely for reasons of seniority. They started studying this before Jennifer and Paolo. And it goes back to what the question back there was. The fact that a book like this has been waiting to be read for several decades, doesn't it have also to do with the ideological preclusion? And is it totally random that is, it has been discovered by two Italians, but who happen to be working in the US,
And this also is a question for Jeff. When you started studying futurism and fascist literature, in the US it was perfectly normal, it was field of studies. But in Italy at the same time, it was still looked upon with suspicion. If you study futurism or fascist literature, fascist architecture, if you do not make a very clear ideological premise at the beginning saying, I hate them, there must be some sympathy or some affinity. So I'm asking you a sort of a history of scholarship question, and whether you think there is something left of these ideological preconcept, and how hard was it to fight it when you started digging out these documents and these texts and the field of studies that you were
Well, there's very different narratives one I could provide for. Like, one would be the scars on my body narrative, which would be the anecdotal one, but another would be a kind of broader framing of this question. In fact, I think I remember actually Paolo and I were, when Luce was actually at Yale, at the Beinecke, I mean, I think I was the first, one or two, like we were, a lot of people didn't think this was material that was very interesting, let's put it that way. For the historians, it wasn't that interesting either. So if the literary historians weren't interested in it, the historians were even less likely to be interested in it. I think I will never forget the first time I went. I wrote, you know, an essay that I think now is considered a kind of classic essay on the Mostra della Rivoluzione Fascista, 1932 Decennale exhibition, an undeniably important event in the history of architecture, installation design, museology, exhibition design period, an undeniably important political event, a mass event that shaped a whole series of features connected to fascism's passage into the kind of regime it became in the 1930s. I gave my first lecture at La Sapienza in Rome on this subject to a very full room, actually. A surprisingly full room to me, at least, because at the time I was in my 30s. And I finished the lecture, which was accompanied by slides, and it was essentially the archivally based reconstruction of how this exhibition was put together, how various cultural forces came together in the to shape the exhibition as a kind of critique of certain kinds of narratives of Italian history, and their substitution with a myth, a revolutionary myth, the myth of fascism as a revolutionary state, and its linkage to certain forms of graphic and artistic practice and architectural practice. So I ended, and there was a kind of mild applause, not very warm applause. And the first person who stood up and asked the question asked me why an American would want to embrace fascist ideology, and not to have it, not to embrace a critical attitude toward these materials. Like, I had just spent an hour talking about the, you know, giving this very meticulous, archivally grounded reconstruction, and it went that way through the entire discussion. There was not a single person who stood up and said, this is actually an extremely important cultural episode that we have to grapple with. And then at the end of the lecture, the same person who led that conversation came up and said, it really, you know, ci vuole coraggio per raccontare la verità. For me, that was a kind of parable of this sort of veil of silence, of hypocrisy, an acknowledged hypocrisy. It wasn't even that concealed, that it was important to maintain a facade of a kind of, to continue the battle against fascism in the cultural domain, to maintain fictions that nobody believes, to deny facts that are palpable and evident facts. But the moment is not yet ripe. And that moment, paradoxically, what I have found, I don't know, I'd be interested to hear your thoughts, but over the course of the last 20 years, I've had the opposite sensation. I've actually felt myself pulled in the opposite direction, increasingly emphasizing the critical aspects of my historical work, as I hear people re-instrumentalizing the attempt to do a serious, scientifically grounded, archivally serious, responsible reconstruction of the cultural history of the 1930s in Italy, which is the defining moment of modernization in Italy. So I find paradoxically, now that the, in a sense, the battle has been won, there's a kind of re-instrumentalization that's happening of people who have political values that they're advancing using what they call, you know, I mean, the construction of cultura di destra, right-wing culture, as if such a thing, whatever that phrase could possibly mean. I don't believe that there is, I think it's a horribly simplifying notion. So I find myself paradoxically actually bouncing to the other side of the spectrum, feeling like I have to assert critical distance to clarify that I'm not speaking, that for me this venture of trying to do a serious, responsible, cool-headed job of reconstructing a key, a seminal moment in the historical record, is not loaded with this other set of ambitions that are buried somewhere in that project. But you know, I don't know if you feel that the same
yes,
way.
Yes, it's a complicated. I have just a technical question in my mind as I was listening, as I was looking at your and Jennifer's illustration. I wonder if part of the difference is the less satisfactory state of archival research, of publication and editing of the literature, especially the poetry. Patrizio has been a pioneer in this, and I think we need much more. Marinetti is not well published,
and
his vast literary production has to be subjected, I think, to the same kind of analysis. It will take a long time. But I'm thinking also, to me, one task that in moments of optimism I think I'll be able to finish, but I think this will go on to the younger generations, is that in this novel, I didn't realize how fully this novel is full of information about the futurists around Marinetti.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I was struck by the continuity of it. I was listening to Arrigo Lora Tottini, I don't know if you know, this avant-garde performer in Italy, in Bologna a month ago, telling how important it was for him to listen to Tullio Crali speak about the things, and Tullio Crali is in the book. So one task I think that has to be developed is to study these other figures, the so-called minor figures, and the poets. There were several books of poetry coming out in 1942, 1943, 1944. So I think we need more archival work, as you said. I don't expect an opposition to this. I have the impression that historians in the state of Italy are much more cool about all this, and perhaps there is a more ideology in literary scholars, but it will be, there is, I notice in Italy, there is this usually great respect for rediscovering philological work, and I think we can count on that, so to speak. But certainly this is just, I think, as far as, if you look at futurist, not simply Marinetti, futurist poetry of these years, in fact, some of them are mentioned here, Pino Masnate and others, this is just the tip of the iceberg. I'm not saying all will be of the same quality, but of course, as Jeffrey knows, you don't have to, you worry about the quality after. We first try to discover what is there, and then we make this thing. It's a very exciting moment, I think, for this kind of research.
I mean, I do think, just as a footnote to what you just said, the in art history, certainly, there's been a shift over the past decade, which I really welcome, which there's a lot of attention being paid, especially in the wake of the centenary, to so-called, you know, second and third generation artists. And in the show at the Guggenheim that's coming up in 2014, there will be a very strong presence of arrow painting to a degree that has never been true of any show. I thought the shows for the centenary were generally, backward-looking.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't revise the historiography, but I think the Guggenheim show will be, at least for American purposes, for Anglo-American audiences, the first show where we'll really see a lot of the futurism of the 1930s and even the 1940s.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So there has been a shift in that sense. Yeah. Maybe literary studies are a little bit of an outlier.
Well, I would like to thank you for being here with us, and to repeat my thanks to Paolo Valesio, Jeffrey Schnapp, Jennifer Scappettone, and Patrizio Ceccagnoli, and remind you that our next meeting for Poetry in the City is going to be on March 5th, and we'll present the latest book by Paolo Valesio, La Mezzanotte di Spoleto, and Davide Rondoni will be here with us for for the event. The event is going to be mostly in Italian, right, Paolo?
Yeah.
Yeah, very good. Thank you again all very much, and thanks for watching.